Thank you. Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What will you give me if I betray him to you?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment, he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of the feast of the unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Where do you want us to make the preparation for you to eat the Passover?" He said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says my time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another, "Surely not I, Lord, surely not I." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written of him. But woe to that one whom the Son of Man has betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas would betray him, saying, "Surely not I, Rabbi." And Jesus replied, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, take it, this is my body." And he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many of the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung to him, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you." And Jesus answered, "Truly I tell you, this very night before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. Then Peter declared, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all the disciples said the same thing. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee. He began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." After going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is at all possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he returned to the disciples and found them sleeping. "Could you not stay awake with me 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away for the second time and prayed, "My Father, if this cup cannot pass unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more, and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. My betrayer is at hand." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With Judas was a large crowd, armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them, "The one I will kiss is the man, arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Friend, do what you are here to do." Then they stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of a high priest, cutting off his ear. Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who takes the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then will the scriptures be fulfilled, which says it must happen this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled." And all the disciples deserted him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. Going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking at false testimony against Jesus, so they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last he came forward and said, "Hey, this fellow said I'm able to destroy the temple of God and build it in 3 days. The high priest stood up and said, "Have you no answer? What is it they testify against you?" But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him, "I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." And Jesus said to him, "You have said so, but I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has blasphemed. What is your verdict?" And they answered, "He deserves death." Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, "Prophesy to us, your Messiah. Who is it that struck you?" Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said, "You also are with Jesus the Galilean." He denied it before all of them, saying, "I don't know what you're talking about." But he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him. She said to the bystander, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Again he denied it and said, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you." And he began to curse, and he swore an oath, I do not know the man. At that moment, the rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus said, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. And he went outside and wept bitterly.
When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. He said, "I have sinned by betraying an innocent blood." But they said, "What is that to us? See to it yourself." Throwing down pieces of silver in the temple, Jesus departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said, "It is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money." After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the Field of Blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price set on him by the people of Israel, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me. Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "You say so." But when Jesus was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you? But Jesus gave them no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now it was the governor's custom to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. After they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas, or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed Jesus over. While Pilate was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent him a message, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And the crowd said,
"Barabbas!"
Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" And all of them said,
"Let him be crucified."
And he asked, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more,
"Let him be crucified."
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." Then again, people as a whole answered,
"His blood be on us and our children."
So Pilate released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of his robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull, they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Above his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he wants to. For he said, 'I'm God's son.'" The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lume sabachthani, and that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, this man is calling for Elijah. At once, one of them ran and got a sponge filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But others said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs were also open, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And after the resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake, they were terrified. And they said, truly, this man was God's son. Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for the body of Jesus, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. So Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate, and they said to Pilate, sir, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive. After 3 days, I will rise again. Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception would be worse than the first. Pilate said to them, you have a guard of soldiers. Go make it as secure as you can. So they went and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and posting the guard.
Jesus' name. When I read this passage, similar to others, emotions arose. I found myself relating to many of the characters in the story. As a mother and a friend of a mother who watched their child suffer from a terrible, debilitating disease, when I read this passage, I couldn't imagine what it must have been like to be Mary, the mother of Jesus, watching as this terrible scene unfolded. Watching her son die the most horrifying death of his time. I wondered what it must have been like to be the women who were with Mary. Could they say anything? Or could all they do is watch this horror unfold along Mary? What do you say to a mother whose child is suffering? Not only suffering, dying by crucifixion, a punishment that was reserved for the lowest class, a punishment that meant being nailed or tied to a cross, naked for all to see, to die a slow, painful, excruciating death by exhaustion or asphyxiation. As a professed follower of Jesus, who has failed many a times to stand up against injustice and to speak of my Lord and Savior with confidence, when I read this passage, I realized what it must have been like to be Peter, who, with the greatest intentions, wanting never to deny Jesus, out of fear, denies him not only once, but three times. And ultimately, the same fear would lead him to abandon Jesus in his greatest moment of need. And as someone who has joined in group think to avoid being the outcast, who has joined in the taunting and teasing of another person because others were doing it, when I read this passage, I could relate to those passing by, the ones in the crowd, and even the soldiers who joined in the taunting of this person being crucified, all because it is what everyone is doing and what their culture taught to do. As someone who has experienced moments of deep depression, when I read this passage, I identified with the pain and the shame Judas must have felt. So much so that this severe depression would eventually cause him to commit suicide, even though he had been taught by Jesus that belief in Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life. And as someone who has often acted without thinking and failed to trust in God's providence, when I read this passage, I identified with the disciple who raised his sword and struck a Roman soldier, only to be rebuked by Jesus for not trusting in God's providence. As someone who has served in leadership, at a time when I knew a poor decision was being made by those leaders, but I failed to stand up against those leaders for the sake of another. When I read this passage, I identified with Pilate, who, although being warned and having the power to change the situation, fails to stand up against these other leaders for the sake of another. And as someone who knows my own shortcomings and wrongdoings, but fails continually to not judge others' shortcomings, When I read this passage, I identify with the criminals on either side of Jesus, who judged him and taunted him for what they believed were his shortcomings. And as someone who has had to assist in burials for loved ones, when I read this passage, I identified with Joseph of Arimathea, who amidst his suffering and sadness pushes through to offer a burial, a proper burial for his beloved one. And as someone who has experienced an untimely death of my minister, who is also a good friend, when I read this passage, I identified with Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph and James, who sat at the grave, staring in awe, stunned by the untimely death of their minister, their friend. And as someone who in my deep moments of suffering has experienced an absence of a connection with friends, and even more so, an absence of God's presence, when I read this passage, I realized that Jesus was abandoned by Judas, by Peter, by all the male disciples, and the crowds. This led to him crying out to God, who he also felt abandoned by, saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? I identified with these words, that questioning, that pain of feeling completely, utterly separated from God. From reading this passage, I realized that the sacrifice was made for me and for you and for all people. I realized that even creation experienced and understood the suffering. Because in the middle of the day, when the sun would shine its brightest, there was darkness and gloominess and cloudiness. When Jesus took his last breath, creation shook, rocks were split, the temple was torn into two, and tombs were opened. Creation, every character in this story, and even us today, are affected by what occurred on that first Holy Week. I believe that many of you here today can probably relate to some of the characters mentioned in this scripture passage. Today, however, let us use those thoughts to help us connect to the suffering that Jesus endured for our sake. Let us remember that at the center of this story, in utter contrast to the disciples and Jesus' opponents, is Jesus, the obedient Son of God, who resists temptation, refused to be rescued by angels. Jesus Christ, King of the Jews, our King, chose instead to suffer through the ridicule and mocking of the Jewish leaders, the bystanders, and the Roman soldiers, who spat on him, made fun of him while he was naked, caused him to suffer. Jesus came to save everyone by refusing to save himself. He came not seeking a divine status. Rather, he chose to accept this cruel punishment, that punishment reserved for the lowest class criminals. Jesus, in his suffering on the cross, identifies with everyone who has ever of God during their deepest moments of suffering. He experiences hell by dying in agony and alone. So as we go through this Holy Week, let us recall that agony, that loneliness, the suffering that Jesus endured. So that when Easter comes, we can truly comprehend God's message for the world.